Excited that you're here this morning. If you're glad to be in the house of the Lord, will you give the Lord some praise this morning? Give a hand and clap. All right, will you stand up and we're going to go into worship this morning. Let's pray before we do that. Father, I just thank you for everything that you do for us. Lord, we just welcome you in this service. Everything that we do for you is for you, God. Lord, I pray that you'll just be with us this morning and that your spirit will just guide us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Your hand is strong to save. Listen to me this morning. We are declaring something right here in this song. I don't want to move beyond this point. I don't know what you walked in here with today, but our God is strong to save. It doesn't matter what you're going through. It says above death, anything. Whatever you're going through today, I want us to sing this again, and I want you to close your eyes. I want you to get rid of anything that's going on around you, not anybody, just anything. And I want you to concentrate on what you are saying today, because what you're saying is truth. He has the ability to meet you right now in the place of your need. We have many guests that are here today. We're so glad that you're here. But we invite you just to receive from the Lord as we sing this through one more time and declare that our God is strong to save. Would you lift your hands and lift your voices this morning? Let's sing it. Father, in the name of Jesus, you are strong to save, God. Hallelujah.
The Lord our God is mighty in battle, and we are not afraid.
Come on, don't be afraid.
Receive it today. He stands through our trials. Our God destroys.
Sing that again.
The Lord our God is mighty in battle. We are above our debt, above our life, above the battles that we fight, above and anyier than they. And I got as strong as they, above the heavens and the earth, above the rulers of this world, above and anyier than they. And I got as strong as they.
Your presence, let us experience the glory
Living God, you're in this place. We thank you that you are here and you are dwelling with us. Let us be aware this morning, Lord, of your presence. Let us be aware this morning that one moment in your presence, this moment that we are in right now, can change our lives. As we wait in your presence, Lord, Spirit of God, speak to us this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Sweep over us this morning, Holy Spirit. Let our awareness that you're here surrender to your Spirit this morning. Hallelujah. His joy, his peace, and his love. Just lift your hands. Come on. Worship him for just a moment. With your heads bowed and eyes closed for just a moment in the presence of the Lord, we have declared that we want to be more aware of his presence. And as we are in your presence now, Holy Spirit, you have spoken to us. You have spoken to us with a word that reminds us that in our lives, no matter what station we are in, you are the first and the last. You knew us before we were formed in our mother's womb, and you know the destiny that you have set for us. You are the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning of life, and the end that begins in eternity. Holy Spirit, we know that you bring the love of Christ to us. Your primary work is One of your primary works is to convict us of our lives, to convict us of places that are not pleasing to you. To reveal Christ to us is another one of your primary works in the earth. You've declared to us this morning to receive your joy, which is our strength, and as your children, we walk in that joy. To receive your love, which is our rest. Father, there may be those in this service today who do not have rest in their spirit because they have not yet received the love of Christ that was brought to us on the cross of Calvary through his death, his burial, and his resurrection. Holy Spirit, you have told us to grab a hold of the peace, and that peace can only come from knowing you. So in this moment, while your Spirit is at work among us, if you're here today, listen to me carefully. The Spirit of God is moving. It's not by any accident that any of you are here today. It's by God's divine providence. For whatever reason you may have come, because you're a member of the church and you feel like you're supposed to be here, if that's the reason, if you came because you love Jesus, or you came because you were invited by somebody, whatever the reason, is no accident. And the Spirit of God is moving on your behalf right now, in this moment. And if you're here today and you'd say, Pastor, I want to receive that love that the Spirit of God just spoke to us, just interrupted our service to tell us to receive the love that is rest. My life has been turmoil, and I would love to have some peace and some rest. Can I tell you, it comes through your relationship with Jesus. And if you're here today and you'd say, Pastor, will you pray right now? I need to ask Jesus to come in and bring that love and forgiveness, and with it comes that peace. Would you just slip your hand up really quickly so I can just include you in this prayer? You need to receive Jesus this morning. You need his love. You need his peace. And with that will come his joy. God bless you, man. God bless you. God bless you. Can we bring the lights up just a little bit? Heads bowed and eyes closed for just a moment. Just bring up a little bit of light. Would you lift your hands one more time just so I can see them? So God bless you. God bless you all over the place. God bless you. God bless you. To receive the love of Christ today that brings rest in the midst of turmoil. Is there anyone else? I believe there's others. In my spirit, I believe there's others that God is dealing with today. This is your time to receive forgiveness, to receive his love, and to receive his rest. I'll wait just another few seconds. Anyone else, just slip your hand up to join these. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. If you raise your hand, I want you to look up here at me. If you raise your hand, I want you to look up here at me for just a second. I want to tell you something. God loves you. God has plans for you that you can't even imagine in your mind. He is your beginning, and he is your end destiny. And part of that today is being fulfilled as you receive, maybe for the first time, his love. Or maybe you're coming back and you're saying, God, I need this love. I need this rest that comes from knowing you. And if you raised your hand and you're looking up here at me, this is what I want you to do. I want you to just lift up both of your hands straight toward heaven. Just lift them up like that. This is an act of surrender. This is you giving your life to Christ, surrendering whatever it is this morning in the name of Jesus. And Father, all over this auditorium this morning, God, you don't see hands, you see hearts. Hallelujah. Saints of God, be praying, rejoicing in heaven this morning. Father, you see hearts of those who are crying out that they need that love that your Spirit just spoke to us about. They need that love that brings rest. They need that peace that comes, and with that peace will bring joy. So right now, Father, as they come to you, I pray that you would reach into their hearts and forgive them in the name of Jesus. Set their life in a right standing with you, that they're able to receive all the love that you provided for through your life and through your death on the cross. And now if you've lifted your hands, I want you to pray this prayer with me this morning. In fact, I want the whole congregation to pray together. Keep your hands lifted while we pray. This is your act of surrender. Say, Dear Jesus, thank you for bringing me here today. I receive now your love for me. Thank you for loving me just like I am. And I repent of my sin. I ask you to forgive me, to wash me on the inside, to make my heart and my soul clean. I receive your forgiveness. I receive your love. I receive your joy. I receive your peace. And now I ask, Holy Spirit, help me to live this life that has been destined for me before I was even born. I love you, Jesus, and I receive you now into my life as Savior and Lord. In your name I pray. And everybody said, amen. Can we rejoice with these who have surrendered their life to Christ this morning? Hallelujah. Come on. The angels are shouting in heaven this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 You can be seated in the house of the Lord. And as you are, let me just say to those of you who are our guests today, and maybe this is the first time you've been in a service that a word was spoken in that way, that is one of the gifts of the Spirit of God that He has given to the church. One of the supernatural gifts of His Spirit that He emphasizes and takes time to speak to us directly. And you've received that word. Those of you who lifted your hands today and asked God for that love and that joy and that peace, He did that for you. But here's the beautiful thing. He did that for all of us. Amen. Spoke to us today. And that is one of the beautiful, powerful gifts of the Spirit of God that He gives to us as a church to speak to us directly this morning. We're so glad that you're here. And I know that you have been welcomed by the presence of the Holy Spirit. Why don't you turn to somebody around you and say, I'm really glad you're here. Hallelujah. Those of you sitting on a row by yourself, crick your neck around and talk to somebody this morning. Thankful for the Spirit of God. Amen. So thankful for the Spirit of God. Can we just take a moment to pray? There are many needs in our church and many needs in our lives. And I just want to take a moment to go before the presence of God as He is here with us in our midst and ask Him to reach into our lives and meet us in the place of our needs. Mike Kelly today is in the hospital with pneumonia. And so we want to pray for him today that God will touch him while we're in this service. The presence of the Lord is there with him in that hospital room. Amen. And we believe that the healing power of God is touching him this morning. So as we go to the Lord in prayer over the general needs of our church, we pray for Mike specifically today. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for your presence. God, that we would be more aware of your presence. Because in your presence comes love, in your presence comes peace, in your presence comes joy. And we thank you for that this morning. We receive it. Father, we come before you as God our healer, asking you to reach into the lives of the family of Harvest and our extended families and our friends, Lord, that we know that are hurting in their physical body today, God. We pray that the healing Jesus would touch them this morning. God, that you'd be in the room where Mike is this morning and bring healing to his body and restore him again, Lord, so he can give more testimony of the healing power of God. We trust that it happens even while we're in this service, glorifying you and experiencing your presence, that you are there with him, touching him, strengthening him, and encouraging and strengthening Sylvia as well, God. There are other needs in our church, God. People that need answers to questions in their life, direction of where they're going, God, I pray that you would grant them that this morning in the mighty name of Jesus. And God, for the work of the church, Lord, that we would be submitted to you and dependent upon you to empower us, to equip us, and to provide for us to accomplish all that you have set in our hearts and lives to do. We surrender ourselves personally, and we surrender ourselves as a church into your loving, powerful hands to lead, to guide, and to direct us. And we submit all this to you right now, trusting you in the name of the Father, the Son, and your precious Holy Spirit, confirming it in the name that is above every other name, the mighty name of Jesus. And all God's people in agreement said, amen, amen, amen. Do you love him this morning? Can you give him a hand clap of praise in his house? Come on. Thank you, Jesus. I'd like to welcome you again into our house. If you're a guest with us here at Harvest, we make you welcome. My wife Tammy and I and our whole Harvest family say welcome to you. Harvest, let's welcome our guests this morning, would you? And we have plenty. Hallelujah. We have a baptismal service coming up in just a little while at the close of the service, and we have many family and friends that have come. But if you're a first-time guest, brethren, if you'll go ahead and keep your eyes open. If you're a first-time guest with us, this is your very first time, we're not going to ask you to say anything. I'm not going to show up at your door. That's my no-hassle guarantee. I'm not going to show up to your house today. But if you're our first-time guest with us, we've got something we'd like to put into your hands as a way of letting you know we appreciate you coming today. Would you just lift your hand up if you're a first-time guest with us? God bless you. Look around, Harvest, at all our guests in the house today, over here, right here in the center, and a few over here as well. We make you welcome today. We're so glad. Keep your hands up until you're given a guest pack, and we appreciate you if you'll take that. If we can kind of get one per family, I think would help us, and there's some information in there. There's also a connection card in there. If you would take that connection card during the next few moments of the service and fill that out for us so we can have a record of your visit. We want to send you a letter and some information about our church and possibly some upcoming events. We want to invite you to come and be with us. And of course, we want you to come back with us each Sunday. If you don't have a church home, we welcome you to come to Harvest. You'll find this to be a very loving and inviting place to come and hang out. And all the Harvest people said, amen. We're so glad that you're here. At the close of the service, if you'll take that connection card out into the foyer, you'll see a table set up out there. We have a very special gift that our welcome bakers have created just for you. A little something you can have for dessert after your lunch today. And I guarantee you it's going to be good, because I've tried just about everything that's been baked back there, and it is evident in my body shape. Hallelujah. But we're glad that you're here. Harvest, let's make our guests welcome one more time, would you? Amen. Just a few announcements. By the way, the ladies had an incredible time at the Fixer Upper event last night. I was across the street and I could hear the noise all the way across the street. They were having so much fun last night, a great time. Thank you to all those who helped and participated. They had a wonderful time here last night at the church. A couple of quick announcements for you. If you're a door greeter, if you're one of our greeters that greet on Sunday mornings, or you would like to be involved in that ministry, very important ministry of the church, right after the service, immediately after the service, right over here in this section where Brother Mike Gorham, Mike, wave your hand, where he's sitting right there. If you'll gather right there for a short and brief but very important meeting, that's right after the service today. And then want to remind you, for those of you involved or would like to be involved in the food bank ministry, that this Tuesday we need to unload and sort food this Tuesday morning, about 9:45, 10 o'clock. If you get here, the trailer should be back. We'll be unloading and then sorting and putting the boxes together, or actually not putting the boxes together this week, but sorting the food in the food bank. So if you could help us with that, that would be greatly appreciated. I want to run a short video clip for you really quick, so if you'll turn your attention to the screens for just a moment, and I'll be right back.
The rich rules over the poor, and the borrower is slave to the lender. Are you really going to make the hard choices to change your life?
We had $40,000 in student loans, $17,000 in cars.
I owned a rental property.
We had a line of credit, just stuff.
We had 16 credit cards.
The proverb says, hope deferred makes the heart sick, but when desire comes.
We paid off $83,000.
Wow! When desire comes.
$144,000.
When desire comes.
$450,000 in the last 7 years.
Wow!
It is the tree of life.
God says this is how you get out of debt. You gotta run! 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 Run!
There is no doubt that this process called Financial Peace University works. The only question is whether you're gonna be involved. And so if you haven't signed up yet, now is the time.
University class, and this is the last Sunday you can sign up. You can make up the first two lessons. And we encourage you to sign up and be a part. We have a few kits on site that are available that you can get right away. It's just $99 for the complete 9-week course. You can make up weeks 1 and 2 if you have not signed up for it. But I want to tell you something. This week, this is a clip from this week's class coming up about getting out of debt. And I want to tell you, it will inspire you. It'll begin to show you the ways that you can get yourself out of debt and please God in a greater way in your finances. So if you would like to be a part of that class, if you will see myself at the close of the service or Miss Robbie who will be outside, let us know that you want to be a part of it. We'll get you hooked up. There's a sign-up sheet out there on the table. So if you'll make yourself available to that and join the 24 of us who are already in there, And we'll get you caught up and you'll have a great time and also get to know some people a whole lot better. So we encourage you to be a part of that. Hallelujah. Pastor Fred is going to come right now. Do you appreciate Pastor Fred Stallworth and what he brings to our church? He's going to come down and receive our tithe and offering this morning.
Thank you, Pastor. Our worship in giving is a very important part of what we do here. A privilege to worship the Lord with finances. It isn't that God needs our money per se, but He lets us enjoy what He's about. He's about giving to us. God is first of all a giver. God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. He gave the very best that He had. And isn't it a wonderful thing that we can give to the Lord? It's a part of our worship. It's not just something on the side of worship. It is worship to the Lord. Pastor John had a scripture Wednesday night. If we could put that back up there. It's 1 Corinthians 16 verses 1 and 2. John said something Wednesday night that we probably need to hear again. He said, you can give without loving. Think about that a moment. You can give without loving. You could do that, couldn't you? I could give you something and not love you. But he said, you cannot love without giving. Love is an act. It's a choice. Giving is an act. It's a choice. I encourage you today, as you give what you bring to give, whether you consider it little or small, bring something to the Lord today of yourself, of your sweat or of your toil, or of the gifts that have been given to you. God has given us so much, hasn't He? And I'm not here to beg in any way, but just to let you appreciate what it is to worship and giving. And I appreciate all, and Pastor does, and those that minister here. So thankful for the giving that goes on here. That's what it's about. Let's read this verse here. This is about some poor Christians in Jerusalem. This verse has to do with Paul asking those saints at Corinth to give to those in Jerusalem. These were poor saints. Those saints at Jerusalem had the Holy Spirit poured out upon them. But you know, they had all things in common after that day of Pentecost. You remember, they lived in community. But it wasn't long till a lot of those Christians were persecuted and in jail. So they had no way to make ends meet. And so Paul writes this. He says, now concerning the collection for the saints, as I have given orders to the churches of Galatia, so you must do also. On the first day of the week, let each one of you lay something aside, storing up as he may prosper, that there be no collections when I come. So for this special offering, he wanted them to get together some money for the saints at Jerusalem. This wasn't just church giving or tithes and offering, but he was giving a special offering for those poor folks. And in this particular instance, he gives and he encourages them to give to those folks because they love those people. Some they'd never seen, but they love the saints. Don't you love the saints today? You know, I'm so glad on the food bank. This is something that I'm taking a little time, but this is something we do once a month, but it takes money to go buy food. Some food is given, but that's money that you give for those saints that stand in line on Thursdays here once a month, and for others that are given to it. It's a part of what we do. Let's thank the Lord. He's so good to us. Father, we want to thank you for how you've given to us today. Just a privilege to speak about giving today. We know it's the key to so much in this life. And we thank you that you've given your very best to us, your Son. And so today, as we give some money, we put money in the plate or a check or whatever, we thank you for blessing that. And we ask you to use it. Help us, we here at this church, to be good stewards of what you have given to us. We pray in the name of Jesus. Let's worship the Lord with our giving today.
All right, as soon as that passes you, we stand up and we're going to worship some more.
You're standing darkness, whose love is mine, and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings. You shake the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That all that you've done for me.
See who brings our chaos.
You brings our chaos back into order. You makes the orphan the son and daughter. The King of glory, the King above all kings, who rules the nations with truth. Justice shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you've done for me.
You're worthy.
And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And worthy is the King who conquered the grave. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And worthy is the King who conquered the grave. And worthy is the Lamb. Is the King who conquered the grave? And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is a failing love. That you would take my place. That
as you're seated, turn around, high five with two folks and tell them he is worthy. Amen. Praise God. Praise the Lord. If you have your Bibles with you this morning, turn to John chapter number 11. John chapter number 11. I'm just going to move these so I don't fall into that baptistry in a few minutes. That would change the order of service, wouldn't it? If I were to fall right into that water. Hallelujah. John chapter number 11. And for those of you who are regulars here at Harvest, you've heard me speak about one of these days, Lazarus is going to get up out of that tomb. Y'all remember? Well, today's the day. Hallelujah. Lazarus is getting up. Had this message on my heart for some time, and the Lord has, for those of the preachers in the house, you know how the Lord sometimes will do you, and His Word tells us that we are supposed to make plans, but then He's supposed to direct our steps. Amen? Aren't you thankful that the Lord directs the steps of the pastor? Right? I'm sure glad the Lord directs the steps of the pastor. And so this morning I want to talk to you a little bit from John chapter number 11, and I'm going to start by reading the first five verses. John chapter number 11, verse 1 says, "Now a certain man was sick, Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. And it was that Mary who anointed the Lord with fragrant oil and wiped His feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore the sisters went to Him, saying, 'Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick.' And when Jesus heard that, He said, 'This sickness is not unto death.'" Can I stop right there for a second? If Jesus says that it's not unto death, guess what? If your situation seems so dire, but yet you know the Lord has told you this is not going to destroy you, guess what? It might feel like it's destroying you at that moment. It might feel like death right then. But if Jesus says this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. Let's pray. Father, we ask that you bless the reading of your word this morning. God, that you'd anoint your servant as your instrument to deliver this word into our hearts and the lives and affect the change that you desire to see in us, to continually mold us and shape us into the image of your Son, as is your desire. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. So here we see in these first five verses, we kind of get the main players that are going to be involved in this story. The first one, of course, is Lazarus. This story is about him being sick and him appearing to die, right? And his sisters, Mary and Martha, and of course, Jesus, and certainly the disciples are going to be involved in this story as well. And verse 5 tells us that Jesus had a special relationship with his family. And what you need to know today is Jesus desires a special relationship with you. He wants to know you so well that he knows which one of you is the worker and which one of you is the worshiper. Now, how many of you know you can be both? And that's God's desire. But in this particular family, he knew Mary as being the one who broke the bottle of perfume. And he knew Martha as being the one who was always working. And not only that, but Martha always noticed who wasn't working too. We can recognize a clear challenge in our life when we get to the place that we're doing things for God, but we're spending some of our time noticing those who are not doing anything for God. Kind of gives us a check on our motivation of why we are doing that work. Amen? So we have to watch ourselves, and that's just a free part of the message, just describing who this Martha was. But Mary, she would take time and she would sit down at Jesus' feet. How many of you believe that's important, to take time to sit at his feet? Even in the midst of working, even in the midst of being busy about doing the Father's business and advancing the kingdom, we need to be careful that we take time to sit at his feet and worship him. That pouring of the sweet perfume was an act of worship, and we need to take time to worship him and to adore him. So we see these players: Lazarus, Martha, Mary, Jesus, and his disciples. And in verse 6, something unusual took place. It says, "So when he heard that he was sick, he stayed 2 more days in the place where he was." When I was a young Christian, that verse troubled me as to why Jesus didn't just drop everything he was doing, because he loved this family, and go check on Lazarus. Anybody else ever just had that question in your mind? Why didn't he do that? And here's how I feel about that. He waited 2 more days before he went, because Jesus doesn't panic over our circumstances. So whatever's going on in your life today, Jesus is not panicked about it. You hear me, all of you Harvest folks, you hear me regularly say, God is not pacing heaven today over what is going on in your life. It hasn't caught him by surprise. He's not wondering what to do. He already has the solution. Jesus already knew what he was going to do. And he waited 2 more days because he wasn't panicked. And if you trust God, if you're a believer and your life is wrapped up in Jesus, if he's not going to panic, then guess what? There's really no need for you to panic either. Because if you believe that you are in the palm of his hand, you believe that you've given your life to him, not only have you received him as Savior, but now you're trusting him as Lord, then he's not panicked over what's going on in your life today. Now, if you're not a believer today and you haven't received Christ, let me tell you, today is the day that you can receive him. Some of you have already done that this morning. Some of you have come back home and reestablished that relationship of trust that brings the peace and the love and the joy of Jesus. But I want to tell you today, don't leave here without making sure that's right. Because when you do, you'll be in tune and in line with a Christ who loves you so much that he knows exactly what's going on in your life, and he already knows the answer and the solution to it. Everybody say, that makes me feel better. Does it make you feel better? Do you believe that to be true? His word says it. So we see in verse 6, and I just believe that Jesus doesn't panic over our circumstances. Then in verse 11, Jesus actually calls it as he sees it. He says, these things he said after that he said to them, our friend Lazarus sleeps, but I go that I might wake him up. The sisters are all upset because Lazarus has died. They've placed him in a tomb, but Jesus is telling them, look, he's not dead like you think he's dead. What did it say up there? It says that the Son of God can be glorified. Whatever's going on in your life, why did God allow that? I've been the Mary and the Martha. I've been there and asked those questions. Why does God allow that? And the answer seems to come back to this passage in John chapter 11, so that the Son of God can be glorified in your life. Why am I having to go through what I'm going through right now? Can I tell you, if you'll wrap your head around the aspect of so the Son of God can be glorified in my life, that peace will come back to you. How many of you ever God has shown up in your life and done something amazing when you thought all things were lost, things were impossible? And you know why he allowed you to go through that? So he could be glorified in the midst of your life. I love it when we take time occasionally to hear testimonies of what God has done in people's lives. And you hear some of the horrible things that they've been through. And you wonder, God, we're your people. Why do we have to go through that? And it's so the Son of God can be glorified in our lives. We can trust him in that. We can take stock in that and believe that. We see natural things. But God, through his Holy Spirit, will allow us to see things supernaturally. And we can see. Daniel, I don't know what all God's going to bring out of what you've been through in the last 2 weeks, but I know that he's going to be glorified, and he already has been in some aspects, but he's going to be glorified through what he has accomplished in your life, even though you went through that. And I got to be honest with you, I have those days where I go, God, can't we give you glory some other kind of way? You know, is there, and yeah, there's lots of ways we glorify God. We glorify him through our obedience. But listen, folks, this is life. We live in a fallen world. Say, thank you, Adam. We live in a fallen world. There are things that are going to happen to us. And it's not just because or not because at all that we sinned that they happen. It's because of sin that they happen, because the world is fallen. But there's stuff we're going to go through, and we need to understand, just like Jesus understood in the life of Lazarus, and Mary and Martha didn't quite grasp it yet, that God is already at work on our behalf to bring himself glory and honor through our life. And that should make us feel humbled that God trusts us enough that he allows these things to come into our life. Now, I'm not telling you to go out seeking for anything. Sufficient for the day is the trouble thereof, right? You don't have to say, God, give me something to go through so I can glorify you. No, don't do that. Glorify him by your obedience. Other things will come, and when they do, just trust him and know that he's got everything in control. God sees the supernatural. The Bible says he knows our end from our beginning. And if he already has an end for you, guess what? You're going to get to that end. If you're his child and he has an end for you already, you're going to get to that end. It may feel like some days you're not. Anybody ever have those days where you feel like you're not going to make it? But God says, if you're my child and I say that you've got an end, you're going to get there. Now, there's an end for those who are not his children too, and they're going to get there. But we want to talk about today this end, this destiny that God has for us. Verses 17 through 31 sets the stage for what is about to happen. Mary and Martha see Jesus at separate times, and both of them said, "Jesus, if you had been here, Lazarus would not be dead." Oh, have we ever said that to him? "Jesus, if you had shown up earlier, this wouldn't have happened." Wow. I'm thankful that I serve the God. The God. I'm thankful that I have a Savior that knows who I am and will allow me to have those feelings. Right? He knows our weaknesses. He knows everything. He knows about us. He knew us before we were formed in our mother's womb. All of those things. And He knows that we feel that way sometimes. If Jesus would have just shown up a little bit earlier, Lazarus wouldn't have had to die. I wouldn't have had to go through this, but we have to change that and not stay in that place and realize that God has something that He's up to. Turn to somebody next to you and say, God is up to something good. God is always up to something good through the power and the working of His Word and His Holy Spirit. Then in verse number 35, let's pull up verse number 35. It says this, Jesus wept. He went to the place where they had laid Lazarus, and they wept, and Jesus wept. I want you to know today that Jesus feels what you're feeling. He feels your hurt. He feels your pain. He feels your disappointment. He feels your desperation. He feels it in such a way that Jesus is always moved with compassion toward us. He's moved. He's touched by the feeling of our infirmities. He is moved. And in verse 35, which I think is so funny when you're a kid in Sunday school and they ask you to quote your favorite scripture and you panic and you can't think of nothing else, it's always John 11, 35. We can always remember that, right? Jesus wept. I'm good for another week. But there is power in those two words right there. Of how much Jesus loves His children. I remember when my kids would go through rough times, and can I tell you that I don't have to go back a long way to see those and remember those times. And I can remember a couple of specific instances where as they were going through there, through those times, and mama and daddy couldn't fix it for them. We wanted to fix them, like Mary and Martha wanted, Jesus, if you had just shown up sooner. But I remember how my heart broke, and I remember weeping for my son and weeping for my daughter. And I'll be the first one to say to you as a father, I wish I had done that more when they were younger. So maybe I wouldn't have had to do it quite as much when they were older. I don't know. But I remember that, and I want you to know that Jesus feels that same way about you. When you're going through times that you can't fix, when you're going through times that seem impossible to you, and you feel like the end is near and that Lazarus is dead and you're dying and it's all going to come to an end, you know that you have a Savior. You know you have a God who loves you and who weeps for you and whose heart is broken for what you are going through. Jesus wept, and now that brings us to verse number 38, and some things are going to begin to happen now as a result of how Jesus feels and what Jesus already had in store. And let's bring up verse number 38, and it says this, "Then Jesus, again groaning in Himself, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay against it. And Jesus said, 'Take away the stone.'" Can I tell you today, taking away the stone in the lives of people in this world today, that stone represents the hardness of our heart. Jesus is saying to us, take away the stone. He is saying to our spirit, remove the stone, soften your heart, remove that hardness of your heart away. Roll away that stone. There are people that God has been pursuing for a long time, and because you've kept a stone over your heart, because you've kept that hard exterior, because you kept that belief that says, I can handle this thing on my own. I can do this on my own. The first thing Jesus did when he went to raise Lazarus from the dead, and the first thing he does when he comes to us and meets us in the place of our sin, is he rolls away the stone. He takes the hardness of our heart away and he moves it. And I remember that day when he came into my life. I thought I was good. I thought I could handle it. I thought I was a churchgoer. I'd been going to church all my life. I thought I had a relationship with God. I had a knowledge of God, but I didn't have a relationship with. And one day he rolled away the hardness of my heart. He moved the stone away. And then in verses 42 and 43, it says this. And I know that you always hear me, but because of the people who are standing by, I said this, that they may believe that you sent me. Now, when he had said these things, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. Lazarus, come forth. I want us all to say that with a loud voice, will you? Lazarus, come forth. I'm telling you, there was authority in his voice because he has all authority. Mary and Martha and those were around, they were worried. They thought, oh my gosh, he's been in there for 3 days. He's going to stink. And can I tell you something? Our life does stink until Jesus comes and brings us out of the tomb. Amen. And they were worried and they were concerned and they thought, he's going to stink when he comes out of there. There's going to be terrible things. How can this even happen? But I want to tell you today that in your life, until you come to know Jesus, until you allow him to speak to the hardness of your heart and roll away that stone, you're going to be in a place where your life stinks. One of the most popular television series out today is The Walking Dead. Now, I have a lot that I could say about that, but today is not about that, and this message is not about that. So I'm going to just let it lie with the simple fact that, sadly, that is one of the most popular series on television, The Walking Dead. But can I tell you something? A person without Jesus Christ in their life as their Savior and walking with him as Lord, they are walking dead. Jesus says, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the... There's no life outside of him. There's existence outside of him, but there's no life outside of him. True life comes, and we are brought out of the tomb of the death of sin into life when we receive Jesus Christ, when we hear him say, Lazarus, come forth. I could picture that sometimes when I think about it on the day that I came to an altar and received Christ as my Savior. And by the way, you don't have to come to an altar to receive Christ as your Savior. But you come to an altar of your heart, you come to a place, and it was almost like I could hear him say to me, Rick, come forth. Come out of that place where you are and come into this life that I have for you. And can I tell you, my life has never been the same. It hasn't always been easy. Has it, baby? She's had to journey it 36 years with me. It hasn't always been easy, but I'm telling you something. God says, come forth. And he's talking to some of you today. Come forth out of that life and let me give you life. Come forth out of that place of death and let me give you life today. Salvation, resurrection from a life dead in sin is what Jesus calls us to. And if you're a child of God today, you can rejoice over the fact that he called you out of your tomb. If you're not a child of God today, he's calling you out of yours right now, this morning. Lazarus comes out in verse number 44, and he who had died came out bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was wrapped with a cloth. And Jesus said to them, loose him and let him go. So can I tell you something? For just the next couple of minutes, I want to park right here. There is a place that we come in, and up till now, God has been speaking and sharing and specifically speaking into the hearts and lives of people who may not have a relationship with him yet, to call you out and to bring you and tell you that he has life for you. He has life that he took time. His Holy Spirit took time in our service to tell us that this life brings love, that this life brings joy, This life brings peace, and nothing else in the world can do that except a relationship with Him. But in this particular passage of Scripture, I believe that we can take a moment and see that sometimes the salvation experience is not where we need to stop. Sometimes in our relationship with God, we do come out, we get saved, we're brought out of that tomb, we're alive, but we're still wrapped up with all the things of our old life. And I believe God is speaking to some of us today to say, loose Him and let Him go. Take off, get those old grave clothes that after 3 days, maybe they did stink. But can I tell you, He was saying, take that blindfold off of Him so He can see. Take that thing off of His head so He can see. And take those things off of His life so He's not walking around in life like this, having to shuffle His feet because He can't move because He's so wrapped up and bound up with the things of His old life. God is speaking to some of His children today to say, come out. Be loosed and be set free. Remove these things off of your life. Better yet, He's really saying, let Me remove these things off of your life. Can't accomplish much for God when you're walking around like this. Can't move. You're too wrapped up, too bound up. But God says, loose Him. Let Him go. Oh, can you imagine what's going to happen when you're free from all of those things that have kept you back and kept you away from the things of God and kept you from doing the things that God has placed upon your life to do, and you're set free and you begin to lift your arms and your hands and you can step and you can move and you can move in the direction that God has for you, and you can do it freely because all these things have been removed off of your life. Roll away that stone. Receive Him as Savior today. And once you have, let the grave clothes, let Him remove those grave clothes off of your life. Don't live a life still bound up with all the things that the world has put about you. He's saved, He's brought back to life, but He was still bound up with the things from His old dead life. In John chapter 10, verse 10, Jesus says, I have come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. He doesn't want us to just be alive and breathing. Lazarus was alive. He had come out of the tomb after the stone was rolled away. He was saved. He was brought back to life. And when you come to know Christ, you're brought back to life. Life is placed back in you. But after you're saved and after life has come back, there's some things that might need to be removed. And I pray today by the power of His Spirit and by the presence of His Spirit that He does that in our lives today. That He sets us free. In a few moments, we're going to move to a baptismal service where in that and in Scripture, it talks about that we are buried in baptism like Him unto death, and then we are raised as He was raised, and then we should walk in newness of life. Can I tell you what that represents? Is those old dead grave clothes coming off of our life, and now we can walk in new life. And these that are being baptized are going to identify with that very thing. They're going to be buried just like Jesus was buried. They're going to come out of that water just like Jesus was raised from the dead. And they're going to step out of this baptismal pool to walk in newness of life with their grave clothes removed. Hallelujah. And today I pray God accomplish that in our lives. Lazarus was not dead. He was just waiting on Jesus to bring him to life. Amen. Jesus raised Lazarus from a life of sin, figuratively for us, and gave us new life. And now, He says, loose them and let them go. Father, in the name of Jesus, God, through the power of Your Word and the authority of Your Word, You've spoken to us today. Holy Spirit, thank You for gathering with us in this place, just as Your Word promises. But not only were You here dwelling, but You spoke to us specifically about the love and the peace and the joy that comes from knowing the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. And God, in this incredible story of Lazarus and his sisters who were doubting, and his sisters who were busy, and his sisters who were disappointed in him. But as always, the hero of the story is Jesus. The hero of our life is Jesus. God, I'm thankful that one day I was in a tomb called sin. And you called my name, called me out, said, come out, let me give you a life. God, I thank you for that life today. I thank you for that life. Right now in this service, in this very moment, with us being in an attitude and a place of prayer, if you're here today and you hear Jesus calling you in the midst of this message to come out, you thought you'd been living, but you're not really living, and you know that now until you come to know Jesus. He knows your beginning, but he also knows your end. And according to his word, he knew that before he knew your beginning, because he knew your end from the beginning. If you're here and you'd say, Pastor, that's me. I need to come out. I need to rise up from the dead. I need to receive the life that comes through the forgiveness of my sin and a relationship with Jesus Christ. If that's you, I want you to just slip your hand up right now, really quickly. Don't hesitate. Don't hesitate. He's calling some of you out. He's giving you opportunity to give your life to him today. If that's you, never asked Jesus into your heart, never asked him to forgive you, never received life. And this is not just life here, this is life everlasting. If that's you, just slip your hand up really quickly. Maybe you're here today, you've received that call out of the grave, saved you from your sin, but you've allowed some of the grave clothes of your old dead life to keep you wrapped up. You want to be set free from that today. He brought this message for you today to set you free. To say, loosen and let him go. If that's you today and you'd say, Pastor, as you close this part of the service in prayer, please pray for me. I need some grave clothes removed. I need to be free. I want to be free. I don't want to live this life that he's saved me to all bound up. I want to walk in freedom. Set free from the lies and the bondages of the world and of Satan himself and walk in freedom. If that's you today, I don't want you to raise your hand. I want you to just stand right where you are. Just stand. Just stand up. Anybody needing to be set free today? Set free from the grave clothes. God bless you, honey. God bless you. God bless you, sir. God bless you. Anyone else, just stand right where you are. Stand right where you are. Come on, the Spirit of God is moving. He wants to set you free. Don't be afraid of freedom. Devil try to talk to you and say, oh, you don't want to be free because you don't know what God has in store. Let me tell you, he only has good in store for you. It says every good and perfect gift comes from above. God bless you, sir. God bless you. God bless you. Hallelujah. Now there's something happens. Is there anyone else? I started to move, but I just felt a check in my spirit. Someone else. Someone else. Just stand really quickly. God's calling you. He's wanting to set you free. He's wanting to set you free. Receive it from him today. Hallelujah. God bless you. There's something that happens when the grave clothes come off. Instead of that static step where you have to just move a little bit, there's freedom that comes with that where you can step freely. So this is what I'm going to ask you to do. This is going to take an act of your courage, but it's also the greatest act of faith that you have, that God is going to set you free. With heads bowed and eyes closed, I want those of you who are standing just to slip out quietly from where you are and come and stand on either side of the baptismal pool. I'm not going to keep you very long, but the Lord's going to set you free. If you're standing, come on. Come on. If you're standing, come right here. If you want somebody to come with you, grab them by the hand, say, go with me. But come on. Hallelujah. 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 I need a couple of men right over here to pray with these two gentlemen, to lay your hands on them. And you, those of you who've come, look up this way at me for just a second. Those of you who've come, look up here at me. Roger, have them turn this way for just a second. We need someone to come right here with Sister Peggy. Ray, hallelujah. Freedom is in this place today, folks. If you didn't come, but you know that God would desire to set you free and you want to be free, it's not too late for you to come. But for those of you who are up here, I want you to look at me. He's going to set you free today. Those things that have been binding you up and keeping you all bound up and unable to do the things that you know that God has for you to do, or maybe you don't know all of them, but He wants to set you free. He said, I've come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. Do you know that you can have joy and love and peace like you've never known it today? And I'm going to pray, and these folks are going to pray with you individually, and all this church that loves God and believes and has been set free are going to pray for you. But here's what you need to do is, as we're praying for you, you need to pray. And if all you can start with is, Lord, set me free, start with that. Lord, free me up. Get these things off of my life. And then if you want to begin to identify them, you tell them to God. You don't have to share them if you don't want to with the people around you. They just come at a point of agreement to pray with you. But I want us to pray right now in the name of Jesus and by the power of the Holy Spirit that freedom comes right now. The Holy Spirit is here. Hallelujah. Those of you in your seats, we're going to move to the baptismal service in just a moment, but there's nothing more important than what's going on right now in this moment. So stretch your hands this way and let's pray for these in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Father. Set free today in the name of Jesus. Walk in that freedom today in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. You're free today, honey. You're free today in the name of Jesus. Walk in that freedom today. God is an awesome God. Amen. I cherish the day that He said, Rick, come forth. Hallelujah. And then I also cherish the day that He said, loose him. Brother Fred, you remember the day that you set free, brother? That the grave clothes fall off of us and we're able to walk in freedom? Can I tell you something, folks? We live in a world today that needs people of God to walk in the power and the freedom of knowing Christ and being filled with His Holy Spirit. And I pray right now for those of you who made a fresh commitment to Him today, those of you who came for freedom, that the Spirit of God fill you fresh and new to overflowing this morning, in this moment, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There is power in His Word, folks. Lazarus has finally come forth at Harvest Christian Center. Turn to somebody and say, I'm so glad I'm free. Hallelujah. We're going to move right now to our baptismal service. And you just take a moment while I prepare and just greet one another again. Talk among yourselves for just another second, and I'll be right back out. God. Where are all our candidates for baptism? Let me see. All right over here. All right. Awesome. Let's give Tammy Morris a God bless you as she comes this morning. All the way down. And then just turn around. How's the water?
It's good.
Is it good? Oh, it is good. It's nice and warm this morning. You can sit down right there. Praise God. It's not too hot. It's not too cold. It's just right. Before I baptize, Tammy reminds me of two extreme baptisms I've done in my life. One Sunday, I got the water so hot that before I was able to baptize them, it was still way hot, and they came out red, every single one of them, with steam rising off of them. It's not that bad today, is it? The other extreme was in Brooklyn, New York, where we had to borrow a building for a few Sundays while our building was coming up to code, and it was in December. We had a group of people that wanted to be baptized in December, and it was the first Sunday in this borrowed building, and we had a baptistry like this. We filled it up. We were so excited. I think we probably had like 23 people that day who was going to be baptized. And we found out the heat in the building didn't work the next morning. And not only did the heat in the building not work, but that little heater that we drop in here to heat up the water, it didn't work either. And that water was bone-chilling cold. And just like the hot ones came out red with steam coming out of them, everybody that day came out blue. Lips just blue. We created special baptismal certificates for them that called them the polar bear baptism candidates. There was a different kind of mist coming off of them when they came up, and you could see their breath when they praised the Lord as they came up out of the water. Today, we're in the comfortable environment where the water is just right. But can I tell you something? No matter if the water's hot or cold or just right like today, following the Lord in water baptism is your public profession of faith, identifying yourself with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It is an incredible moment in your life. Tammy and Roger, we've been knowing them for a while, and God has begun to do just some incredible things in their life. And I'm going to ask you a couple of questions, Tammy, and just want you to respond appropriately. But do you love Jesus? Have you asked Him into your life to be your Savior and your Lord? You ready to serve Him? You know, when you come up out of this, from this day forward, you're going to be identified as a follower of Christ. You're going to walk in newness of life. Doesn't mean life is going to be the bed of roses that we'd all like for it to be, but what it does mean is we won't go through this life alone anymore. And what you're telling not just those in this community, but or in this body of believers, but in this community, is that you love Jesus and you're going to be identified with him, and he's ready to use you. Are you ready for that? All right. Is there anything you'd like to say before I baptize you? No. All right. That's the 99% answer right there. And that's okay. Well, based upon your public profession of Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, having received him and the forgiveness of your sin, it is my honor and privilege right now to baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, rejoice in heaven. Hallelujah. Miss Crystal. Think the water's nice and warm? All right, good. Crystal, I'm going to ask you a few questions too. This is an important day for you, honey. I want to say this about the water of baptism. There is nothing special about this water in this respect, is that it came right out of the faucet, just like what we drank this morning. But what makes this water special is that it identifies a new life. And Crystal, I haven't had the opportunity yet to get to know you and your husband. Looking forward to that opportunity. Thanking God for providing that opportunity for us. But what I do know is that anybody that comes up these steps and comes down into this water is making a statement that Jesus has become Lord. Do you love him this morning? Have you received him into your heart as your Savior? You know that when you come out of here, your life is going to be identified a different way. Yes. You know what that's going to mean too, is that your friends might look at you a little different. But you know what? Tell them you got baptized, and then you can tell them about Jesus. Yes. Amen. Yes. Amen. Well, based upon your public profession of faith in Jesus, it's my honor now to baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Praise God. Pastor Derek. And let me just say this about Derek before he gets started to baptize this young man. I'm thankful for our youth pastor. I'm thankful to serve along side a young man whose commitment to God and to the body of Christ and to this house is unquestioned and unparalleled. He don't like for us to talk about him that way. He's up here every Sunday leading worship, but what you don't know is Derek gets here about sometime between 6:30 and 7 on Sunday mornings. He's the first person here at this church. One of the last ones to leave on Saturday night. It's because he loves God. He loves this house. He loves you. And he loves these young people. And he's pouring into them. I count it a great privilege to be able to serve alongside of him and to pour something, I hope, into his life. But it's so awesome to watch him pour into the lives of the generation coming behind him. And so he's coming now to baptize this young man. Hallelujah.
Well, I once heard somebody say something about baptism that baptism kind of signifies Jesus ruining your life. And that doesn't sound so great. It sounds kind of harsh. But whenever you hear a message like what Pastor Rick spoke this morning about how our old life is death. We're walking dead. We're the walking dead. And in that moment, whenever we realize what Jesus is going to do in our life, is awesome. And I'm excited about Daniel here. I'm excited about what the Lord's doing and how he's working in his life. And Daniel, I have a couple questions for you. First off, have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Do you love him? Are you going to serve him and follow him? You have anything to say? You want to sing for us? No. All right. Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. If you are family and or friends, thank you, ma'am, of any of our three baptismal candidates today, will you just wave your hand? I want y'all to look around. Look around, look around. Hallelujah. Praise God. We're so glad that you're here. And we invite you to come back and be with us. If you don't, as I said earlier, if you don't have a church home, I think you'll find Harvest Christian Center as a welcoming, fun place to be, where God is glorified and lifted up and His Word is preached and taught every time we gather together. It's been a joy to be in the house of the Lord today. Can you say amen? Amen. If you have not been baptized yet, we have water baptism every other month. So this is February. Our next baptism will be in the month of April. We invite you to let us know right away and we'll make plans for that. And if you have not followed Him in baptism since you've received Him as your Lord and Savior, or maybe when you were young you were baptized but you didn't really understand what that meant and you would like to be baptized again, it's an incredible, incredible moment in your life. So just let us know and we'll make a service in April for you, available in April for you to be baptized. Brother Jerry Fleming is going to come in this moment and he is going to dismiss us in prayer. Thank you again for being in the house of the Lord today. Don't forget our greeter meeting right after the service. If you're interested in being a part of that, I'm sure they would welcome some more folks to help them in that ministry and all the other announcements of the church. Make yourself aware of those. Be involved. Help us expand the kingdom of God. Amen. God bless you today.
You know, what better service could you have than you had today? We've had souls saved. Praise God. For you who have gotten saved today, the scripture tells us that every angel in heaven is rejoicing over you. Not just the ones here who witness it, which is a great joy to us because we went through it too. But all of heaven's rejoicing because you got saved. You are that special to God and His kingdom. And then the baptism. That is a requirement of God to be baptized. He tells us that when we get saved to be baptized. The showing of going down and becoming a new person. It is wonderful. And then having a pastor who preaches a message like he preached this morning. I tell you what, if you leave here today and you didn't say you were touched, you need to check. Your wood may be wet. Let's love the Lord in prayer and just thank Him for the day and ask His blessings upon us. Father, we come to You, Lord, to thank You, Lord, for what has all happened today, Lord. Lord, for the ones who have been saved, Lord, Lord, for the ones that You are tugging on their hearts now, Lord, that if and they leave this place, Lord, that Your Holy Spirit will continue drawing them and they will open their heart to You, Lord, because they don't have to be in a service, Lord. They can be in their home or in a car anywhere, Lord, that they'll give their hearts to You, Father. And Lord, for the ones who were baptized today, we praise You for them, Lord. Thank You, Lord, for their giving themselves totally unto You, Lord, and showing the world that they are a child of God. We praise You for that, Lord. Father, we thank You for a pastor that has a heart of Christ, Lord, that loves each and every one of us, and He loves this world just as Christ loved the world Himself, Lord. And Father, we just thank You, Lord, for sending Your Son that we may receive this salvation. It's so precious, Lord, and so costly unto Him, but Lord, but so freely given to us. Father, we just ask now that You would go with each of us, Lord, as we leave this place, Lord. Keep Thy hedge around us, protect us, and keep us, Lord. Help us to go out and touch the world, Lord. Lord, as You had disciples that touched the world, Lord, we have so many more here than the 12 disciples. Lord, let us go out and touch the world as they touched the world, Lord. Lord, You have given us the power through Your Holy Spirit to do this, Lord. Now, Lord, help us to open ourselves up and say, we will touch this world one person at a time. Go with us and protect us and keep us until we meet again. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You're dismissed.